is like the wind.
If you can't conceive of nothing, cause you just let it be, it's nothing good. We just love you. I'll be good.
What's the deal? It's your boy, Boy. I met man what he said. You know where I'm at. You know what it is, man. I am here with one of the most talented, sexy Latinas to ever touch a stage. I'm going to get in trouble for saying all of this. But nah, man, definitely, man. This sister has been a powerful influence in our music. Lumidee, what's up?
What's going on? Thank you for having me here.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah, yes, for sure.
You
yes.
know, you took about 8 flights to get here, man. You know what I'm saying? Must
it
be
was,
nice to have
it was
money,
a little. It was a little ride. It was a little ride.
See them Puerto Rican yeah. women, right? See what happens, right? So let's jump in, man. Mm-hmm. I have like 1,000 things I got to ask you.
So let's start with one.
All right.
Yes.
So the first one is, when did you find your love for music?
Oof. So it's really random where the love for music started. I want to say it's between two people, and it's Pat Benatar and Madonna. But I was like, I don't even know
Pat
how old
Benatar?
I was. Pat Benatar.
How did you come across
okay,
Pat Benatar?
I found a tape in the street, right? I was with my mom.
Makes sense.
Yeah, and there was a tape. There was
no
a tape.
Chat.
Yes, there was a tape that was just on, like, on the floor, a cassette mm-hmm. tape, right?
Of Pat Benatar.
Of Pat Benatar.
Okay.
And I took it, you know, I took it home, whatever, played it, just kept playing it. And that was Love is a Battlefield. You know, Love is a Battlefield. There's so many... You ever seen the movie Billie Jean?
Billie Jean, yeah.
The girl cuts all her hair off. He's like, I don't know.
I'm just like, yes. Okay.
Pat Benatar is like, she's like, I want to say,
you know,
like alternative
do? Right
rock.
Now, we're going to that clip, Pat Benatar. We're going to see what
Love is a Battlefield.
Love is a Battlefield. We're going
yes.
to that right now.
Yes.
Wow, this is actually phenomenal. I cannot believe what I just watched.
Yes. Little
so
Kim,
Pat
even,
Benatar,
used, Little Kim even used a Pat Benatar sample before. But okay. yeah, I'm just saying, when she did that, I was like, I'm not the only one. But and Madonna, you know, and these are early on, you know, like really stages of just me loving music, not having any idea that it's something I would do. Mm-hmm. You know, just the obsession of it, Madonna, Salt and Pepper. And then as I got older, I want to say for me, where I felt like it shifted was the Aaliyah, mm-hmm. you know, Lauryn Hill, Missy Elliott. Like, that was like, whoa, okay.
And that just kind
of yeah.
And
Mary J. Different. Mary J, first of all, is queen. Mary J was everything. Like, because she was the first person to me. See, I'm looking at Madonna, I'm looking at Pat Benatar, but I don't relate. I like the sound, I like the look, but when I seen Mary J, it was like, she looks like us. She looks like my cousin. She looks like my aunt. She looks like, you know, like her style, her swag, everything. So
I can see that.
Yeah.
Mary J, you.
Yeah,
you know.
It definitely, I connected and related to her. And okay. I was like, it made me feel like maybe I could do this. You know, even though I'm super young, I have no know-how how I'm going to do it.
How old are you, you know, when you found that tape?
Wow, Pat Benatar?
Yeah.
I ain't going to lie, I probably was like six. I probably was like five or six.
That's incredible.
Yeah, my love for music started super early, like super early, you know. But the time where I figured out I want to do this, I can do it, was looking at people like Mary J. And then...
So how old were you then?
Mary J. The beginning of Mary J. I definitely was still like... not in junior high yet, you know. I was beginning of Mary J.
So that means you was like, what, fifth grade?
Even earlier. I'm in elementary. I'm in elementary, yeah, with Mary J. Yeah, definitely. Because it's like, I'm looking at it and I'm like, yes. You know, because I'm looking at her like my aunt. I'm looking at her like my... And what, Mary J is like 17 years old. So I'm trying to think of why did I look at her as, you know, like the older girls I want to be. You know, she's like, she's in that pocket of the girls I'm looking up to that's on the block, that's fresh, that's looking, you know, they look dope, but then they got this swag and then they tough. You know, Mary had everything. She was beautiful.
She was a representation of what a New York girl.
Exactly.
Kind of that around the way girl.
Yeah.
Approach.
And for me, and then just her continuation during the years and her just growing and growing, it was like the love never stopped, you know, for me and looking at her. So, and then Missy Elliott. With me, I started with writing poetry, so I would say when I heard Missy, I was like, I never heard no writing shit like that. That was
different.
Yeah,
Missy's always been an incredible artist.
And the things that she was talking about was like, you know, you're used to really hearing about love and heartbreak, and Missy's like, she's talking about beat me, and me, I'm super high, super duper fly, and she's doing all these different things, and you like, she's singing like this? This is different. This is like, so for me... I want to say I felt like I, in my mind, it was like the mashup of these worlds, you know? And then Aaliyah with the swag and the vocals and all the, like, echoes in her. Like, the first time I recorded, I was like, I want the Aaliyah echoes. Can you give me those Aaliyah echoes? It was like, can I get that
echo?
Wow,
that is crazy.
And the funny thing is, I just remembered that. So, you know, it was a mixture of all that, you know. Lauryn Hill with the passion, with the poetry, with the rapping, with the singing. You know, she just shows you could do both of those things and dominate. You know, people will take you serious doing both of those things.
Yeah, makes sense.
Yes, yeah.
So you had, you know, I was never clear. I know that you had a medical situation. You let it be known, which is why I'm asking.
Okay,
At 14.
Yeah.
Can you kind of talk to us about that?
Rheumatoid arthritis.
What exactly?
Rheumatoid arthritis.
That?
So it's, you know, most people is like your grandma got arthritis or, you know, like it's more of an older
arthritis
people.
Arthritis
with your joints and your bones. So I've got rheumatoid arthritis where it's kind of just attacks all your joints early on. And
how does that affect music? Did it affect music or was it?
Oh, well, how it affect me mobile-wise, it was it became hard for me to move around. And at a time, I couldn't even go to school. You know, my hands was locking. And nobody knew what it was. They thought it was lupus at first because I started out with, like, this rash. And, you know, in lupus, you start out with the rash and then your bones start cramping up. So it's a lot of similarities between rheumatoid arthritis and lupus.
Gotcha.
So the doctors thought I had lupus at first. And it wasn't that. It wound up being rheumatoid arthritis. But I was kind of treated with those medications at first. So it was serious. But you taking steroids, you taking all these things just to function. It's swelling you up. And these are like your first teen years, so I kind of went through it, yeah. So,
I can imagine you had you experienced some level of identity issues and stuff like that.
Oh yeah, definitely. Okay. I went back and forth with that, but it's like most of my life, like it's like the gift and the curse. It always gives me something that it's like you're gonna struggle with this, but there's gonna be a light at the end of this road, you know. Had I not chilled and been at home with my thoughts and my feelings, I would have not known I had writing skills. I would have not sat down and wrote poetry that later became these songs, you know, became music. Because I knew I always wanted to do music, but I didn't know I had the talent until I started writing, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's where the me being sick just led to that, you know? And getting to the point of taking the right medicines and actually getting on track with my stuff, you know? Wow. That happened years later, but, you know, early on, people seen me and it was like, I don't know if people heard of prednisone, methotrexate, all these medicines that swell you up and everything. So I went through a lot of the, you know, oh, you're chubby, but I'm like, I'm not chubby, I'm swollen. But it's like, how do you fight this? All right, I'm a chubby girl, whatever. You know,
so this was happening all while your career was going on.
I mean, yeah, later on, yeah, I was still, yeah, because it never goes away. You know, I have this for the rest of my life. I just have to treat it, you know, and keep it under control and make sure that it doesn't get worse, you know.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, but if anybody is struggling with this, I will recommend Embryo. Change my life. Change Embryo? My life. Embryo, okay. Yes, it's definitely something that.
All right, we need to get an Embryo check. So.
it's a serious thing, man. Like, you know, I would have not been able to move around on stage and been able to continue had I not found this medicine, you know? So.
Got you. Yeah. Completely.
Yeah, and they are not sponsoring me. So they are not.
I always had a question.
Okay.
What influenced you to remix Honestly into Never Leave You?
Oh, you know things.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
We work over here.
Yes,
I don't know those other people that interview. They're saying, my God, I love you, Dan. Nah,
no,
man.
You know, wow.
We focus,
a lot of people don't know that. Yeah, so Honestly was the first, was before Never Leave You. And I don't know. It was just the time of, like, you know, Bad Boy and Diddy doing remixes and you always loving the remix even more. Like, oh, that's fire. They did a remix. So I'm just, like, looking at myself, like, of course, I'm not at no level yet, you know, but these songs are being played in the clubs, you know, because I was at the time signed to this, a DJ that plays at clubs. So I'm like, what if I do a remix and, you know, something that's just a little more up-tempo? And it just pops in your head. So I was like, okay, why not? You know, Diddy could do a remix. Why I can't do a remix?
Oh, you was trying to compete with Diddy, son?
Exactly.
He's like, yo, I'm the Latina Diddy.
Exactly.
Take that.
Yes. Why not? You know, so.
So did you ever expect the song to blow up the way it did? And let's be real, like, nobody ever expected, like, but like, when you heard it, was it like, did it gravitate
to
you?
No, it was on another, all right, first, when I wrote it, right, I thought, yeah, this, it felt like something, right? But when I recorded it, it didn't feel like nothing. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes you hear something in your head a whole nother way, and when you put it down, it's like, oh, that's not it. That's not
gotcha.
It. But the beat at the time wasn't it. Mm-hmm. You know, we had a whole nother beat. It was not the Diwali rhythm on it. So the beat, I wasn't feeling it. It wasn't. So I was like, this is not what I thought it was going to be. Whatever. Move on. We doing more records. It don't matter. But once we put it on that Diwali rhythm, I felt like, okay, this is something. And I'm not gonna lie, like, my idea of writing it was write it in a way like if you was Mariah Carey, right? So the beginning is like the, honestly, if it's out. So if it was Mariah singing it, you know, she got that airiness and all that. Like, what if Mariah sung this? How would it sound? I'm nowhere near Mariah's vocals, but that was the idea of how I wrote it, you know? Mm-hmm. And sometimes, and then you would never think that when you hear it. But I think that's what gave it that feeling, like this beginning, then the drop, and the whole buildup.
Got you. So I'm going to ask you something. And I know this question comes up a lot.
Yeah.
And, you know, just the way you want to answer it. Mm-hmm. DJ Ted Smooth.
Yeah.
You guys had this bond that we kind of all witnessed. And then that bond disappeared.
Yeah.
Do you feel that bond was disrupted because the record began to take flight? Other people became, like, you know, what happened?
Exactly? What happened?
You know what I mean?
In all honesty, I think it was the success. And it was, like, I gotta keep it real. Like, in hindsight, now looking back and me being older, you know, I probably would have answered this differently before, right? Mm-hmm. But in me being older and looking back at how things took place, I think it was, I think Tell was used to being the star, right? Because I met him, he's DJ Tell Smooth. He's, and from my neighborhood, he's the man.
He's that guy.
I was like, wow. I was proud, like, mm-hmm. yo, Ted likes my shit. Ted is playing my stuff in the club. Like, you know, this is the big bro, like, and he's, you know, bringing me out. Like, this was
he's like a the blessing. DJ Khaled for you.
Exactly. You know, right. So I think when the song took off and it was like, okay, this is still, everybody in New York knows Ted got his hands on this. You know, this is Ted's artist. So when we started traveling overseas, mm-hmm. like, this is one situation. I never mentioned it, but I had an interview overseas with this big radio station. I believe it was in Berlin. And the guy, you know, all my interviews were with Ted. Ted mm-hmm. was in all the interviews. But overseas, they don't know Ted Smooth. Mm-hmm. They know this record, Never Leave You. They know. Yeah. And so the guy was like, okay, you know, I'm ready to interview you. So we all come in. And I'm used to coming in with Ted, mm-hmm. you know. So I come in, Ted's there, and the guy's like, oh, you know, I don't want to interview him. Like, I'm just...
They want to interview
Interview
you.
The artist, you know? Mm-hmm. So I look at him and, you know, I have this... I'm just loyal to T. I've always been this way. So I'm
yeah,
like...
you give me that impression.
Yeah, yeah. I don't play that. So I'm looking at him like...
your cousin outside right now.
That's my sister. It's my sister.
Oh, that's your sister?
Yes.
Okay.
Sister, yeah. So I look at him like, what we doing? You know, what you want to do? He's like, you know, he starts spazzing. So Ted starts spazzing, like, ah, nah, we out of here, then, you know, fuck this, you know. So I was like, okay, so I guess we out of here. So I get up and I go. So the guy is, like, looking dumbfounded. And at this moment is when I still didn't realize it at the time, because I'm like, I'm rolling with my crew, you know.
Yeah, like my crew don't
if
get
we
in,
out, we out. Yeah,
we exiting,
you know.
Like, that's
so
how it is.
I think this was, like, the turning point, you know. And somebody that was there came to me and was like, yo, I think you should do the interview still, though. Like, I understand they don't want to interview Ted, but this is you. Mm-hmm. You know, like, they don't understand who Ted is. You know, like, they don't understand who Ted is. And, you know, we bring in this New York shit here. Like, we global now.
Yeah, you're in Berlin.
You're in Berlin.
You
so,
ain't on the Bronx,
yeah, they're not
going to
talk
not,
about
yeah.
she left because they didn't want to interview Ted Smooth. They're going to say Lumidee got up.
Yeah, and walked out of an
and
interview.
And walked out of an interview just because she.
Just because her people couldn't get in. And it's going to make you seem real deviant.
And real crazy.
And like, you know.
Yeah, so they told me this and I'm like, yo, I didn't know what to do. I did not know what to do. But I was like, in my mind, I'm like, all right, I get it. So I go up there. I do the interview, but I'm giving the dude mad attitude. Like, I'm doing it, but I'm shady. And I'm like answering the questions like I really don't, but I still do it, you know.
And how old are you when you
do this? So at this, I'm 19.
Okay.
You know, so I'm like...
And you came in the game when you were, what, 16, right?
No. I mean, well, I started with Ted early on, but I was 19
when
broke out.
Yeah.
19.
19.
Yes.
Okay, so,
yeah, so
all right,
so
you just
the
in
beginning.
The cusp of things. Okay.
This is it. This is right here. I could have been already 20, 19, so I could have been 20 already, because this is like once we hit overseas, mm-hmm. you know? To be honest, after the record, me and Ted didn't last too long. You know what I mean? So that was like... So I feel like that was a turning point. And everything in the tour changed from then. Like
how
the mood, the energy, the mood. It was like his side versus like my side. And it was a weird feeling. It was odd. It was weird, you know. So, and now I realize for him it was different, you know. And I get what probably he was feeling. But at the same time, I'm your artist.
Yeah,
I'm
signed been, to I would have been like, yo, listen.
Do this, Lou. This is for you to do. At the end of the day, I'm signed to you. My win is your win. It doesn't matter. This is our
yeah,
win,
that
you
makes
know?
Sense.
So, but I was following. I didn't know shit about the game. I didn't know nothing. I was, whatever they told me to do, I was doing. Mm-hmm. You know, whether it was with a fight or not, I was doing whatever they told me because I had no knowledge of anything. You know, I had no knowledge of the game. I knew I wanted to do music.
Wow.
So to me, that was when it started turning. And it started, and as soon as I started opening my eyes and just asking questions, like, okay, of course, I'm just going with everything. But, you know, there was time I was doing shows and I didn't know what I was making in the shows.
Yeah, because you're trusting that the people yes. that brought you in the building are taking care of that.
Exactly.
And that's a typical yes. thing in this, yeah. in this game.
And it was fine because he's brought me in. So I felt this loyalty. I almost felt like I owed it all to him. But it comes to a point that you don't owe it all. Like, you got to know what you're making before you get on stage. And I had an accountant and she was like, I don't know how to deal with your stuff because I don't know what you have coming in and you don't even know how much money you make a show. So you got to get your shit together, girl. Like, girl, what's good? You know, like, mm-hmm. so I was like, okay. So once I started asking these questions, like, so how much is the show? It was like, oh, why you need, oh, apparently now you need to know how much you make a show before you do it.
Yeah, because I need to know what you're giving me in the envelope.
So, but literally this came out his mouth.
Wow.
And this came out, you know, the camp, it was him, it was G48. And I got no ill will. I'm older now. Like, listen, I got love for him for just
and if he was
seeing
smart, he
what he's
told
seen.
You, yo, he'd be making $5,000 and saying, I'm giving you $500. You probably would have been happy.
I didn't.
You didn't. You just like, yo, I'm on stage. I'm performing.
I didn't get it, you know. But yeah. at this point, there's people coming in. I'm paying accountants. I'm paying lawyers. I'm paying. People are asking me questions I don't have answers to. So now I look crazy. So now I got to ask you questions. And the truth is I should have been doing
asking
this.
Asking questions.
You know, so, and it wasn't ever like a suspect thing until they started acting like it was. I didn't ever question it in a way like, hold up. Like, I just was trying to be responsible. Like, you know, I got to grow the fuck up. You're like, and they didn't like that. So then this little rumor started like, oh, she's Hollywood. Oh, she's this, she's that. Anybody who ever met me, there's no Hollywood bone in me. You know, like, I'm the girl they met before. You know, I just have to ask these questions. So they made me feel guilty for that. They made me feel, and they started kind of just, like, shutting me out. So, and it from then on, it just was, like, it turned that we did this big tour overseas. And after that, it was, like, it was done after that. We came back and we never really reconnected again.
So you haven't spoken to him at all? Like, when's the last time you spoke to him? No.
The last time I spoke to Tess Move was 2004.
Wow.
Yeah. It was 2004. Yeah. And it was outside in my grandmother's building on my block where we come from, 119th Street. And it was like an argument. It was like a disagreement, like, bro, just let me off my contract because they weren't reaching out to me. I was reaching out to record. Nobody was answering me. Nobody was, they straight. And then they had this Christmas party one time in the studio. And I remember going and, you know, I'm there. I feel awkward as fuck because we're kind of not clicking. And they bring in a girl, another artist. And she's like decked out with the fur coat and all this. And I'm not into this glam yet. I'm still a fucking tomboy. So I'm like, okay. So they like, oh, yeah, this is going to be the new artist on Straight Face. And it was like they were trying to chastise
me. They were trying
me.
To tell you in a very indirect way that you're chewing
we moving
down
on.
No more. We moving on. We got somebody.
Yeah.
That we going to take it because we took you there. So we're going to take her since she don't want to rock with us. I got you.
And at that time, it wasn't that I didn't want to rock with them. They was just kind of flexing their power to make me feel small and be like, you got to come over here and kiss our ass if you want. You know what I mean? Because we're the ones. It ain't about you. It's about us. It's about me.
Wow, man.
But ultimately, I didn't even know that we got dropped from Universal. That I heard it through the grapevine. And I bumped into an A&R. And he was like, yo, what happened? You know, we were asking for music. And at this time, I was signed to Motown. And they were like, yo, I bumped into Kadar was, you know, asking for more music to drop the second album, and they were saying you was on vacation and you wasn't recording. I've never taken a fucking vacation, okay? The first time I took a vacation was 2 years ago. Every time I travel, it's for work. It's for work. It's to, you know, like, it was none of that. So I think it was just them trying to sabotage it, and then they were trying to pitch other artists, but bro.
Because they had the line in with Universal already, so they figured like, yo, I blew this up, and now they trying to position somebody else in.
And it didn't work.
And it didn't work out.
So it blew up to, y'all both get dropped. Boom. And that's it. And it was, that was done. Man. But, you know, that was that. And thank the Lord for it. It is what it is. It happened early on, you know, and I was able to move on from that. You know, like, I've traveled the world still, you know, and been putting out music, put out albums, caught multiple deals, singles, licensings, everything, you know. So, you know, God bless him, you know, God bless him. Because at the end of the day, I don't ever forget that beginning. I don't forget that bond we had and how we was creating in the studio. And it was dope. You know, it was dope. But that greed kicks in.
I feel you. That I've come greed. Across a lot of people that you help them with something and then, you know, they get funny and let people get in their head and let them kind of gas them to a point where they just, and
you're like, it's like, who are you?
Yeah, you're not the person I met. When I met you, you was doing this.
Yeah.
We went and we put something special together and we got here and now you want some other stuff.
Yeah,
you know, but God is good because God will always show you the light.
It's true.
For where you need to go. So,
exactly.
You know, wow.
Yeah. So that's what happened with Ted. You could chop that down, but I know that was a long story.
No, I'm gonna give it to the people as they want it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you know, like I told you, we keep it 100 here.
Yeah.
You know,
and there's no
to know, like, you know.
And that's 100. There's not a fib at all. Like, we could sit right here. He could never say. I don't lie. There's nothing. There's so much other things I could say that I leave out. You know what I mean? So,
we're gonna talk about that off.
Yeah, that's the good part.
So you know what amazes me about you is what inspires you to create all these different genres of music that you do? Because you don't you bounce. I noticed that 1 minute you spit in and the next thing you techno and then you do what's up with you? Where you at?
I mean, what's up with me is finding a Pat Benatar tape when I was 5 years old. That's what happened, you know? And listening to all this music and never feeling like this is my music. You know, like when I told you when I seen Mary J, I connected to the look, I connected to the image, I connected to where she was from, but I still listen to every type of music. Mm-hmm. You know, so I felt that it was easy for me to just do these things without thinking about them.
Gotcha.
You know, without feeling like, oh, let me try to do this. It's just a beat comes on and I'm jumping in. You know?
So you're doing all these different types of music. So do you think that, like, doing these different types of music takes away from what you're doing or helps with you see what I'm saying?
Because
some people will be like, well, she's a train and she's on every track.
You need to
find out exactly who Lumidee is. Is she a rapper? Is she a techno person?
That happened early on, you know, definitely, like, with they wanted me to choose, are you rapping or are you singing? What is it? You know, but I felt like I've never had this power voice, right? You know, I got these dope ass melodies. I'm melodic. I got lyrics. I'm writing my joints. So I feel like I'm going to sing my songs, you know, but when I rap, it's stronger. It's more aggressive. I feel like I'm more in control, you know? So I felt like I didn't want to choose.
Mm-hmm.
Why should I?
Makes
I could
sense.
Do both, you know? And at this point, nobody asked anybody to choose shit. Everybody's doing everything. Rappers are singing, singers are rapping, everybody's doing everything nowadays. But back then, it was hard for me.
So you started a kind of label thing.
Yeah, right? I mean,
do you have a label?
I have, yes, Low G Music.
Low G Music,
yes, Low G Music.
So based on your experiences, is that what kind of triggered you to start Low G Music? And like,
and
how does
do
that work?
Own,
like, what if I'm an artist and I say, I want to get down with Lumidee and be on Low G Music? Walk me through this process.
Oh, wow. Okay. So, I've done this, right? Like, I had somebody who, I had two people on Low G Music before, right?
Okay.
And taking them on tour with me, you know, we put out records, things like that. But now I feel like I'm restarting that because sometimes you're giving so much to people and they don't realize, they feel like they should be where you at already, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I'm struggling to stay and to get more, you know? And I'm like, you're investing in an artist, you're doing this, but they kind of seeing where and they think they should be there, but you got to work to get there. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And early on, it wasn't that easy like now. Before, it was like, I got to get you a deal for this to come out. Mm-hmm. Now, we could just go on TuneCore, post that shit up, bang, you on Spotify, you on all outlets. It wasn't like that, you know, when I started Low G Music and when I was going independent, you know. I needed somebody to pick my music up and put it out, and this is when I was working with people. So I think it would be a different thing nowadays with me putting out an artist, you know. Mm-hmm. But I feel like right now I'm trying to find...
You come from a time when you had to earn it.
Yes. And they never let me forget it. Like, it was always like, you got to pay dues. You came out here with this hit. be like, yeah, yeah, we love the hip, but like, who are you? What is this? You got to pay dues. And I ran around everywhere doing shows for people, free shows, doing this, doing that, paying dues. Mm-hmm. Paying dues. And now people jump out and it's like, it don't matter. Oh, you got a joint? Bang, everybody's on it. Mm-hmm. And everybody's, you know, and helping it kind of get to the next level. I didn't have that help. I didn't have reach outs. I didn't have people like wanting really to work with me like that. Mm-hmm. You know, and if I did, I wouldn't know.
Because those people were blocking those blessings.
Exactly.
To you.
If I did, I wouldn't know. Sense. You know? So it was more of me figuring it out always, you know, on my own and, you know, whoever was with me at the time.
So what would be your advice to an artist aspiring to get to, you know,
where to
you
just be? Do
yeah, what would you be your advice now?
Like
what
advice would you now? Do?
Would it be a classic approach? Would it be like, what would be your advice?
I mean, right now it's a lot easier. It's a lot easier. And take advantage of these things, you know, that are easier now. Take advantage of the tools that are in front of you. You know, for me, I find it hard to be constantly on social media. You know, I'm trying to get better with these things. But I would say a new age artist, yo, do everything, you know. And the main thing is, be responsible. Do what you say you're going to do. Show up where you say you're going to show up. Respect the people that are working with you. You know what I mean? And they got to respect you also. Demand that respect. You know your business. And at the end of the day, have fun. Because I want to say, people say, wow, don't you wish you could go back to 03 when this record was huge and everybody was all, and you was everywhere? No, I don't. There's nothing. You couldn't pay me to go back to that. I was miserable. You know, it wasn't fun. I couldn't enjoy the moment. I couldn't grasp it. It was just like, as soon as you came up, it was everybody trying to beat you down. And I felt that, you know? So it wasn't, I would say, have fun. Do what makes you feel good, yo. Mm-hmm. That's the most important thing. Because what's the point of doing all this and making money and not enjoying it, you know, and not being around the people you love and having fun? All this impressing people shit? Fuck that. You know, like, sometimes people want to impress people and, oh, I'm doing it on people, I'm doing this, and having all these people around because their popularity, do they really fuck with you? You know, like, if
that's
you down.
That's the real question. Yeah. I can appreciate that.
So, and that's something that, you know, I've learned.
My philosophy has always been, it's better to be worth knowing than well known.
Exactly. Yeah.
And people don't understand that.
Yes.
You know,
yeah. That's a good one. That's great. Because, I mean, that's the thing I see. With whoever I come into their life, like, I'm going to add value. And whoever I allow into my life, we need to add value to each other. You know? It can't just be this thing that's like, I'm here because you could get me in here. Mm-hmm. Or I could get, I don't, you know? Like, nah, that's not yeah, yeah.
So you feel social media has played that big, you know? Is that the difference between and then?
Yeah, yeah, because there's a lot of fronting. And before, people would do it in music, but now it's like, yo, let me take this pic. And you don't even know what people got around them. They cropping everything out. You know, it's just so much fucking foolery going on. Like, so you don't know what to believe, but people make it look good. And I think it's a great time for artists because people, you know, they eating this shit up. So if you got good music and, you know, you want to stand for something, then fuck it. You know, do it. But at the same time, send the message out that's right. You know what I mean? That ultimately counts for something, you know?
Let me ask you, what makes you scrap, like, songs or projects that you might want to work on? You know, you got these songs and you're like, I ain't really rocking with that. I'm going to scrap this, you know?
Me not playing them over and over. If I have a record that I play once and I don't feel like I want to play it again, what's the point? You know, and time. Sometimes you hold on to something for so long you think it's old, you know, and it's not old and it may be great to other people. So I've learned this. It's like, yo, just put it out while you feel excited about it. You know, while you feel good about it, just do that. And that's what I did this time.
Whatever happened with La Luz? Yeah.
Oh my God, yo, you're too focused. You're too focused.
Focus, man. Just got to holler at me.
Yes,
man.
Yes. What happened with life? You know, things taking part in your personal life that kind of makes you push everything back. you know? And then when you go back to those records, you're like, that's not even me anymore.
Okay.
You know, like, I don't feel that that's what I want to put out there. Like, I've already... It's crazy how you can grow, you know, like, just by situations in your life, and you just become a little more you or who mm-hmm. you're supposed to be, you know? And certain things just don't even connect to you anymore.
Okay, so...
Yeah.
I told you I was going to ask you questions.
Yeah,
I told you I'm built better than them other dudes. My team's strong over here. Man. Yes. We ask the real stuff.
La Luz, man. But La Luz, that... Yeah,
so it seems good, like the light. You know, because I'm a Libra. You're a Libra.
Yes, I'm a Libra.
There we go.
Yes,
see?
yes. Libras
don't
go.
That's right, baby. We
genuine
run the world,
people,
man.
Genuine people.
We emotional.
Oh, yes.
And yo, if you do something to us, it can be like, yo, we'll never rock at you again.
It's true.
But we're the most loyal people, and people do not understand Libras like that.
So
here it goes. The album is 10/13.
Yes.
Right? That's your actual birthday?
Yes.
So I'm 10/2.
Oh, wow.
So, you know, I'm a real Libra.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes.
Inspiration for this album,
10/13. 10/13. Okay. So, shout out to my boy Ibrahim. This all came about with him. He's the producer of pretty much everything on here, right?
Gotcha.
Minus two tracks that were produced by Mike Streets. We met, like, him, me recording other stuff, on the journey of me trying to work on all these other records and all these other projects, and he was an engineer. And he was just cool as fuck, and I remember early on, I don't know, we were recording and me mentioning my birthday just passed, and he's like, oh, word? When's your birthday? And I was like, October 13th. And he was like, oh, that's my birthday. And I was like, are you fucking serious? That's crazy. Like, I never... really met somebody with the same actual birthday as me. So when I met him, we clicked like that, you know? And mm-hmm. I was looking for an engineer, and I have forgot at this time, and we linked up again. Long story short, I was recording a whole nother thing. That kind of fell out, the music. It just didn't work out. And he was just like, yo, you know, like, I could run circles around these producers. And I was like... You talking shit? Like, what's going on? Like, what's happening? Yeah, so he was like, yeah, I was like, well, let me hear what you got then. He just started playing stuff, and he was doing this music that didn't even need lyrics. You know, music that is just talking to you, and it's going, and it got all these levels, and I was like, wow. Like, I love this, but I almost don't even know how to approach it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so nobody really ever made me feel like that, to be honest, that it's like, this is so dope, it don't need lyrics. But if I put lyrics on it, then it's even that much fire, you know? So we just started experimenting and stuff and recording. And the first record we did, that was, this is when I realized we could blend. Because you could be dope, but don't mean we're going to be dope together.
Yeah, there's been instances like that.
Yeah.
You know, and not to cut you off, I completely understand that. A lot of artists and people don't understand certain sounds don't go with certain. Like even in when you go L.A., and you go, when you go East Coast, West Coast, it's a different sound.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's a different audience and all that. It doesn't mean that West Coast isn't dope, East Coast isn't dope.
It just
means that it's a different sound and it takes time to build. Like Snoop was a dude that had to really grow over here on the East side of things.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
It's weird. So it's like the bop is different.
Yeah, you just,
you
like,
know,
yo,
everything
it's a dope.
Is.
Like, I've seen Dre work with artists. Yeah. You know, like, I've seen, and you know, like Rakim is one of the greatest lyricists ever. And I remember when they worked on a project together, wasn't successful.
This is what I mean. Like people,
you know what I mean?
Get this question, like, who do you want to work with? I'm like, you know, the people I love don't mean I want to work with them. Because I don't even want to taint that. I want to continue to love their music and be, because we could try something together and it don't work out. And then I'm always have that little bitter feeling or that feeling that, damn, but what we did didn't work, you know, and feel whack about that. But ultimately, some things are not meant to be. Yeah, you know. So when I realized we had it, was I had this Christmas record I wrote, but I wrote it to no beat, and I kind of tried it with two other people. Mm-hmm. Like, yo, you think you could do a beat to this? And I would sing them the melody, and they've tried it, but it wasn't, you know. So I tell him, and I'm like, yo, I sing it. He starts messing around with it. He slows it down, and I was like, yeah, but if you do it like that, then I got to slow it down. He's like, yeah, just slow it down some. So I'm like, all right, slow it down. doing this. So I was like I was like this. Like the song was like, the real Christmas, jolly. Mm-hmm. And he kind of made it cooler. Mm-hmm. You know, so I was like, oh shit. Okay, I see what you're doing here. I like it. You know, it was like a little bit of a challenge. Mm-hmm. And I fuck with that when it works. You know, like I like to be challenged. I like for somebody to be like, why don't you try it this way? And when I do, it's like, oh, I didn't even think of that. Mm-hmm. But it works, you know, and it's still us working together. So once we did the Christmas joint, that's out. It's called Sleigh Ride, you know. I knew we had something. So then we just started working.
So you know what was interesting to me when I listened to your joint?
Yeah.
You really didn't have any features.
Oh, no.
You're absolutely really no features. Except one dude. Yeah. I can't remember his name.
Ready. But, Ready.
Okay, Ready. So you did a feature with him.
Yeah.
So I'm sitting back and I'm saying, traditionally, when artists back away from the game and then attempt to come back, they begin to call in those favors.
Oh, yeah.
Like, yo, I need you. You didn't do that.
Nah, because I'm going to be honest, it's been a blessing. Like, throughout my career, I've had so many features. On my second album, like, I got features with Snoop. I got features with Wyclef. I got features with Shaggy. I got features with Pitbull. I got features with Busta Rhymes, Fabulous. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like that's why I was bugging. I'm like, yo.
I got features with Styles P. Like, I
don't understand who you are.
Features
like,
with Dave East. It's crazy. I got features with Bodega Bams. Like, the features go on and on. I'm sure there's people that I'm even leaving out, you know. But I've been blessed that way, mm-hmm. you know, to where people like, yeah, I'll do a record with her. Yeah, let's do something. And so at this point, it's like, yo, I just need to rock with myself for a minute, you know, and kind of like not do something with the thought of who could be on this. Mm-hmm. It's like, who the fuck are you today, Lumi? You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, who is Lumidee in 2021? Mm-hmm. Who are you today, you know? And that was like what E brought out. That's what the producer brought out. So I felt like it was a great thing. And then Mike Streets, we got this two records on there called Vibe and Strange, which has Ready on it. Me and Mike Streets have recorded before. We did Tokyo. We did Mars. We did Be Good, you know, and we did some dope ass shit together, you know. So this was something, two records we started 2017 and we never really completed. And I always felt like, yo, I'm hearing them now and I'm playing for people and people feel like they fresh. So I was like, yo, okay, I'm gonna just add these. We're gonna update them. We're gonna, you know, sharpen them up.
And this
is gonna go in there because it was like me starting this new version of myself at that time. Just so much shit in life happens, you know, that you don't get to express it and put it out there. So that became, you know, what this project was. Like, who am I today? And the music I listen to, you know, sometimes it's like you're doing this music because this is what people think you are. And mm-hmm. people tell you who you are. And I don't believe that shit no more. You can't tell me who I am. I got to know who I am, mm-hmm. you know. So ultimately, that's what this project is. This is who I am today. This is like me doing the music I love, doing the type of music I listen to. Like, I listen to this shit like a fan.
Got you. So when you were doing it, because like I said, you run on many tracks. So I was trying to figure out when I'm listening to her, is she going in a dance direction? Is she going in a techno?
Yeah, there's not really techno. I mean, we got Time on there. Oh, the Tokyo remix mm-hmm. has that kind
of
festival.
I told you I was listening, son.
Yes, yes. At the end. That's why I put it at the end, because I was like, I don't want to confuse nobody. But the Tokyo remix, which was originally done by Mike, the original, I felt like, see, this was 2017 when I put it out. And like I said, I didn't get to push it. I didn't get it, but I always loved the record. So I was like, let's update this and bring it into this world. So let's do like some festival shit, some shit that make you feel good, you know? So that's what Tokyo was. And, you know, I've traveled the world and I do these type of events, you know? So it's like, why you don't have a joint in the chamber for this, you know, mm-hmm. when you're doing this kind of event that just relates, you know, to the people and connects. So that's where that comes from. And everything else is just what I'm feeling and my mm-hmm. mood. And I feel like with the project, when you hear it all, it is a vibe. Like, it's taking you on this trip and this feeling.
It's like I'm on a roller coaster ride when I'm listening to the music.
Yeah, yeah. It's taking you on that ride, and that's how it feels. And in the beginning, you're like, okay, it's cool. But it all I'm emotional. So I think in listening to it, you could feel that I am very emotional, and that emotion, you could feel through it that everything I say, I mean, I'm feeling it. There's a real...
We on our Libra stuff.
That's yeah, yes, we yes. Libras. So it's definitely a Libra type of thing, and I'm trying to balance it at all, you know?
That's what's up.
Yeah.
What's your favorite record? See, I like Addicted.
Okay, Addicted is, yeah,
and
it's
there's
a
another
groove.
One where you're rapping. I think that's the only one I think that you're...
Fria.
I was listening. I told you, V. I hit that a couple of times. I was like, okay.
Yeah.
So she's spinning. She's trying to let them know I'm still hip hop.
Yeah.
Don't,
you
know,
yes.
Don't yeah, let this that's other lane that I'm creating.
Yeah,
you
like,
know what I mean?
This is who I am, but I could always tap in. When I, you know, like, yo, sometimes I feel like this. Sometimes I am that girl again. You know, so that's what Fria is about. And that's why it's at the end, because I could take you through this emotional journey, but sometimes I could just be like, oh, word? Fuck you too. You know what I mean? Like, if that's how you feel, like, so that's what Fria is about. And that's actually, I'm working on the visual
so
for Fria.
Which is your favorite?
My favorite at the moment, my favorite period is Time.
Time, okay.
It's Time.
Cause Time was good.
Yeah.
Time
is definitely different, though. It's different. It has a lot of things going on.
It was like, I didn't know if you was calling a dude, like, yo, it's time for you to get it together.
Yeah, and it's almost like asking for another chance. And
yeah,
at
so
this
that's
time,
what I figured, like, yo,
you
let's
will
go.
Get it. You'll be better this time, you know. But for me, when I hear it, it just connects in a different way because I recorded it at a time where I started losing people in my life. So it reminds me of the people that I didn't get enough time with.
Got you.
So this is why the connection with me and the record is different. You know, like, yeah. But let me know, as far as I go through these moods and it's like, today, now, let me know is like my joint.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when is the music video for Not?
Oh, for Fria. The one for Fria is coming out.
Okay, but what about Not?
What do you mean?
There's, unless I'm getting it twisted. I might be getting twisted. I gotta go back to the thing. I heard there was a record, Not. Oh, man.
Okay. Hold on. Let me see what you're trying to, We got Addicted. We have Time. We have Let Me Know.
There's
Back
not.
To You. It's Back to You. Then it's Strange. It's New Vibe. And Fuck All Your Worries.
We're going to get back to it. I'm going to talk to you about this now.
Fuck All Your Worries, Fria, and Tokyo Remix. So I don't know what's not, but it has to be on there if you talk about it's something that you translate it as not.
Yeah, I translate it. I created my own title.
Yeah, you got your own joint going on right now.
I'm trying to come in. I want to be your A&R, son.
Okay, so we got to rename some shit not, okay? Yeah.
What other songs off the album are you planning to do visuals for?
Well... In my mind, when I did it, I was like, I'm doing visuals for everything. You know, everything. Everything's having a visual, you know, but...
That's the dinero.
Yes. Then I was like, hold on, how much is this coming out to?
You're like, it's my son's birthday.
It's a lot of things happening. So right now, I'm going to take it as it goes, you know, and what people gravitate to, you know. But I, you know, people really love New Vibe. But at the same time, I feel like I want to give visuals to things that people probably are not catching yet.
Got you.
You know, and you're not catching it, and I know what this could be with a visual. You're going to get it. So that is why Fria is that, because Fria's in your fucking face.
Yeah.
And when you like, oh, okay. You know, it's Spanglish, so it gives you a little bit of, it's new Lumi, you know, and it has this global world type of track behind it, you know. But, you know, I'm rapping, and it's real nonchalant, and I'm laid back, and it's unapologetic, you know. So, yeah.
So I'm about to ask you this question.
Yeah.
And I always call it why.
Why?
I call it why.
Okay.
Nicki Minaj or Cardi B? Why?
Ooh, that's hard.
I know it's gonna be hard. That's why I asked
that's
you that.
So
question.
Hard. Damn.
Because you love both of them.
Yes, yes. Okay. I gotta keep it 100. I'm go Nicki.
Okay.
The body of work already.
Okay.
That's why. The work is there, you know. Cardi, I love the first album, you know. I love her personality. I love that, you know, she comes from the Bronx. She's like, you know, I go places and other places. They're like, you sound like Cardi B. I'll be like, yo, it's a New York thing, bro. It's not that I sound like Cardi B. It's just New York girl, you know? But Nicki, like, it's these, she's just like, you know, she when she's rapping, she just like is climbing and climbing and climbing and taking you. And you like, what the, what is she going to say next? What okay. is she going to, and that Pink Print album is like, that shit just hits the heart with her vocals. I think she displayed like so much versatility, Nicki, you know, as far as with her vocals on that and then with the rapping, and I just related to a lot of it. And the body of work is there. Like I said, you could, you know, it's time. Time.
Got you.
Yeah.
Jay-Z and Nas.
Oh, oh my God. Dang.
I told you I was going to hit you.
Yeah. I mean, why? Listen. Okay. I'm going to go Nas.
Okay.
Right? Why? Because Jay-Z, obviously, but from, you know, is great. And it reminds me of the time when I first started going to the club, sneaking in. I wasn't even legal yet, but we knew people, you know? So it's a great memory. But Nas was like this, what the fuck is that? When okay. I first heard it. Nas was like kind of life-changing, you know? Like when you first heard Nas, you felt like you something was shifting. Like, who is this guy? He's, you know, and the If I Ruled the World and the shit that he did on the Sting beat, the just all these records that I don't know, the One Mics, all the, like, he has these records that make me feel, you know?
Okay.
Yeah.
90s hip hop or 2000 hip hop? Oh. Cause you're a 2000 baby.
Yes. Dang. I'ma go with
you love the 90s, so which one?
I would say I'm late 90s.
Late 90s.
Late 90s. 98 was a fucking great year. 98 was a good year for albums and music. Like, Nori's album came out. I was like, oh my God, when Nori dropped. Cam's album first came out. Like, 98 was a lot of music, a lot of shit. Like, so I would say late 90s. Late 90s into the 2000s, into early 2000s, you know, like Dipset's early 2000s, G-Unit, all that shit. But like, I gotta go with the late 90s. Yeah. Okay. Mobb Deep was in the 90s. You know, like, that was when you was really listening to shit. Like, I ain't gonna lie. Like, I don't really listen to, I ain't gonna say I don't listen to rap shit no more, you know, but unless it's that, you know, kind of going back and to those people like the Lox doing the shit with Dipset, just kind of was like, whoa. I was just, my daughter didn't even understand what I was going through in the house watching this, like the verses, you know? It just took you back to like, damn, yo, how music was, you know?
Okay.
Yeah.
I got you.
Yeah, yeah.
One more I got. I'm going to take it back because you're a female
yes.
artist, so Little Kim or Foxy.
Ooh, dang. Damn it. I really liked Foxy a lot. But damn, I wish you would've... Okay. Truth be said, I loved both of them. But at the time, my age when they came out and who I was, because I had friends that was relating to them. I wasn't relating to the lyrical content. You know, when Eve came out, that was more, oh, this is the girl that I could relate to. She's tough. She's sexy.
Oh, so we bumping Little Kim and Foxy out and we just saying Eve? Is that what we doing?
I'm just going if I'm gotta go Little Kim and Foxy, it's Kim.
Hey, that's fine.
No, it's Kim listen. Because Kim with Biggie and the joints, she got joints that get me hype. It's Kim.
You know what's crazy to me? I'm talking to you, and we've mentioned a couple of times, it just seemed like you would have been a good Bad Boy artist.
Oh, yeah. I thought so, too.
It, son. She wanted to be on Bad Boy, son.
You crazy?
Where was you at, son?
I would have loved that. I would have loved that. I think that could have been a thing, but I was signed to Test Move, you know. I know Diddy wanted, that was a thing. It was supposed to, it was a whole thing. That was a whole thing. But that would have been great.
So artists, yeah. unsigned artists, please yes. pay attention to the people that's on your team and say that they're representing you. Yes. I always tell people it's good intentions, bad results.
Yeah.
So it's imperative that you have people on part of your team that understand the plan. Yeah.
And sometimes it's not how many people, just the right ones, yo. You know, and sometimes you got to go at shit alone. You know, and that's where I'm at today, kind of. Like, yo, you don't see my vision? Just please back up. You know, just back up. Don't try
that's
to.
That's a Libra talk. I'm like that too.
Yeah, yeah.
If you just don't understand what I'm doing it's and cool. you don't want, then you got to go. I really don't have that time. But yeah. I get it, man.
Yeah, so that's where it's
so
at.
So
yeah.
I want to thank you for coming out, hanging out with me.
Thank you. This was fun. This was fun.
Yeah, this was dope. It was like just this energy in the room, you know. And and we Libras, so, you know, it's just Libra season.
Come on, it scales. It is what it scales, man. Over
you
here.
Know what I mean? So just tell everybody, so Power's Industry, home of new music and entertainment, you know, Power 105, DJ Will, DJ Rainbow couldn't be here because they off, you know, doing some stuff, but we keep the boat floating and we do our thing.
It was supposed to happen. Like, yo, shout out to Rainbow and Will. I love them, you know, but I think it was supposed to be a Libra thing. 10/13
is
out right now. This is all Libra energy, Libra vibes.
This is what it is, man.
Yes, yes. That album is
out. You know, we in October, baby. Let's get it.
Yes. Yes.
So tell them where they can get you on social media platforms.
All right.
And all
At Lumidee on Instagram. Everything else is like inactive. I'm just on Instagram at the moment and getting badgered by my niece. So I'm about to do TikTok. I'm going to just do it.
That's what's up, man. Thank you for hanging out with me. Like I said, Power's Industry, home of new music and entertainment. You know what it is. Let's get it.
Yeah.